Now, I know a lot of you guys don't want to hear this, but I am almost completely sure that Apple Silicon Macs, including the M1 Macs, will never support eGPUs. And to make it even worse, I have a feeling that eGPUs in general are going to slowly but surely die off as well. But before I explain my theory and how this is going to eventually happen, I want to quickly give those of you who don't know what an eGPU is a brief rundown on the history of eGPUs. On October 27th of 2014, the Alienware 13 gaming laptop was revealed. And alongside it came a graphics amplifier that would boost the gaming performance. The only problem was that it used a proprietary connector, so it could only work with specific Alienware laptops and nothing else. Thankfully, on June 1st, 2015, Intel unveiled Thunderbolt 3, the new high-speed standard which took advantage of the USB-C port to enable super-fast data transfer speeds. And then in October, Dell unveiled their new XPS laptops, which were the very first computers to come with a single Thunderbolt 3 port. And then finally at CES 2016, Razer released their Core eGPU enclosure, which connected to their Blade Stealth laptop or any other laptop with Thunderbolt 3, and it accepted basically any graphics card out there. This was a game changer because it also worked with Dell's very first Thunderbolt 3 equipped XPS laptops, which quickly grew in popularity. And then we soon started seeing users sticking high-end graphics cards like the GTX 1080 into the Razer Core to greatly improve graphics performance on the Dell XPS laptops. People quickly realized that this was the perfect solution if you wanted a thin and light laptop for portability, but also wanted to do some gaming. And then in October of 2016, Apple revealed the completely redesigned MacBook Pros, now packing up to 4 Thunderbolt 3 ports, which makes it perfect for eGPUs. Now this is where it starts to get very interesting. At Apple's 2017 WWDC event, they revealed support for eGPUs, and they even created a developer kit for testing, packed with an RX 580 graphics card. So of course, we had to get our hands on one, and that was way back when we used to work for Apple Insider. We ran a few tests and we quickly saw that eGPUs were going to be a huge deal for MacBooks, giving us almost 3 times more raw graphics performance in Geekbench 4. And then we ran a video editing test on Final Cut Pro, and the eGPU helped finish the BruceX benchmark in half the time. And in every video editing test we ran in Resolve, the eGPU boosted performance, even though we were still using a beta version of macOS High Sierra. Over the next couple of years, we made various eGPU videos, including gaming on Mac videos, where we continued to see excellent performance gains. At one point, we compared a fully loaded 15-inch MacBook Pro for $3,500 to the base 1300 MacBook Pro 13-inch with a $700 eGPU setup, and the results were amazing. The eGPU greatly boosted performance in many different video editing tasks, and it absolutely destroyed the 15-inch Pro in terms of gaming performance. So our conclusion was that it made more sense to go with this 13-inch eGPU setup and save around $1,500 since the eGPU is upgradable, so you can keep it for future use. But unfortunately, when the 2019 15-inch MacBook Pro was released, we realized that eGPUs had one major issue that would eventually lead to their demise. Even though the eGPU allowed us to get crazy amounts of graphics power, over double the performance over the dedicated Vega 20 graphics in the MacBook Pro, it actually slowed down real-world video editing performance. Yes, that's right. Everything from basic 4K H.264 exporting and HEVC codec footage was drastically slower with an eGPU compared to just having the MacBook Pro by itself. And then for 4.5K RedRAW editing, the performance stayed basically the same. So if you chose to buy an eGPU for your 15-inch MacBook Pro, you would literally be wasting money and potentially slowing down performance. And ever since then, we have only been recommending eGPUs for 13-inch MacBook Pros, especially when the 5700 XT graphics card was released, which gave us massive amounts of raw graphics performance, even beating out the $2,600 16-inch MacBook Pro. This was even more apparent for gaming performance, with the eGPU giving us over 50% more FPS compared to that 16-inch Pro. So the base 13-inch MacBook Pro with the 5700 XT eGPU was our recommended setup for gaming. However, when it came to real-world video editing performance, we started to see the same exact issues. This time, the 16-inch by itself was faster in literally every single video editing test that we ran, even though the raw graphics power was much lower, which at first didn't make any sense at all, and then we finally figured out what was causing this. When you're doing real-world work like video editing or anything else, data has to travel back and forth between the CPU and the graphics. And the problem with eGPUs is that they are connected using a single Thunderbolt 3 cable. So essentially, the data has to travel through that cable to the eGPU and then back through the same cable. And since there is a limited amount of data that the cable can support, this essentially creates a bottleneck in the system. The CPU is stuck waiting on the data from the eGPU to come back to it before it can continue doing its work. So the added latency really slows down the entire system. And that's why it was possible to actually get slower performance when adding an expensive eGPU. And in the case of the 16-inch MacBook Pro, it's able to perform great by itself, even though it has much lower raw graphics power, because both the CPU and the dedicated graphics are right next to each other on the logic board, connected by a high bandwidth internal connection instead of a cable with limited throughput. And this is finally where Apple's M1 Max come in, which are the first Macs in years to drop support for eGPUs, so let me explain why. As we all know, Apple is eventually going to transition their entire Mac lineup over to using their Apple Silicon chips, with the M1 chip being the first of its kind. Apple's number one priority for the M1 chip was to pack everything from the CPU, the graphics, the RAM, and everything else into a single chip. And if you're wondering why, it's because this drastically reduces latency by having everything literally right next to each other, so data doesn't even have to travel through the logic board at all. Everything that has anything to do with the processing is on the same chip. And that is why Apple's M1 Max are so incredibly efficient at real-world performance tasks like Logic Pro music production, Xcode programming, and video editing, where we've been getting better performance than we expected out of this tiny M1 chip. And that's why I believe Apple dropped support for eGPUs on M1 Max, since they would add a massive amount of latency to the entire process by sending data through a Thunderbolt 3 cable, basically ruining the one thing that makes the M1 chips so good, which is low latency. So just like we saw with the 15-inch MacBook Pro, I believe that an eGPU would have an even worse effect on M1 Max. And I think that Apple knew it, and that's why they dropped eGPU support. And if we look further out into the future, we know that Apple will transition all of their Macs over to using Apple Silicon chips, which will all have the same focus of minimizing latency to improve performance and efficiency. So because of that, I don't think eGPU support is ever coming back to the Mac. The added latency from data going through a cable will absolutely ruin real-world performance, no matter how good of a graphics card you throw into the eGPU. So that is why eGPU support on Macs will soon be a thing of the past. But what about eGPUs for Windows systems? Well, with desktop PCs, you have the option of simply plugging your graphics card into one of the PCI Express slots, which gives you much faster performance, again due to lower latency. And as for Windows laptops, eGPUs haven't really been that popular since there are so many laptop manufacturers that are willing to make the laptop thick to get a high-performance graphics card in there. Apple was not willing to do that since they want their MacBooks to be thin and light, which is why eGPUs became so popular for Macs in the first place. But on the Windows side, we now have a ton of gaming laptops with high-end dedicated graphics that are powerful enough to not even have to consider using an eGPU. And as chip technology gets more advanced, like with AMD's latest super efficient RDNA 2, gaming laptops will be getting even better. AMD even showed off 1440p gaming at 60 frames per second at ultra settings on an RDNA 2 powered laptop, which should be coming within the next couple of months, no longer requiring an eGPU to get great gaming performance. So because of that, I think that the market for eGPUs is shrinking, especially with Apple dropping support on M1 Max, killing off the number one market for eGPUs. And I believe that very soon, eGPUs will eventually completely die out because Windows laptops won't really need them anymore. So there you guys have it. Hopefully you learned something new from this video. And if you totally disagree with me, go ahead and comment your thoughts down below and definitely click the circle above to subscribe and check out one of those two videos right over there. Thanks for watching and we'll see you in the next video.